You are about to take part in a time-traveling road trip through pop culture. A road trip with a clear destination and many stops along the way. This is but one act of one chapter of the serialized journey.
So if any of you feel that you do not care to subject your nerves to such a strain, now is your chance to, well, we've warned you.
I'm a damn good imp.
When we last left off, we continued our deep dive into MST3K's 8th season with a quadfecta, that's 4, of Universal International B-movies, a little story about a man named Jed, and mantises in our pantises. This week we cover the next batch of episodes, an uninterrupted run from the budget-conscious, quality-deficient masterminds of American International Pictures. Past Lives, Mutant Ladies from the Year 5000, The World's Frumpiest Hypnotist, Injection-Induced Lycanthropy, and more greasy, stained walls than you could ever hope for. As always, I am Ryan Rodriguez, and you were stuck with The Coolness Chronicles Season 1, The History and Legacy of Mystery Science Theater 3000. Chapter 11, Sci-Fi Odyssey, Act 4, The Teenage Monsters of A.I.P. Since we're discussing an uninterrupted run this week, we'll first detail the history of American International Pictures, or A.I.P., some of which we covered in Chapter 6's Hour on Roger Corman, and it all begins with one man. James H. Nicholson, born in 1916, spent his childhood fostering a love for movies. In his teens, he started as an usher at his local theater, eventually graduating to ticket taker, then projectionist, and eventually theater manager. Nicholson was gifted with great instincts and always seemed to have a knack for publicity and market exploitation. By the late 1940s, he was managing two theaters for a chain in Omaha, Nebraska. This occupation became untenable in 1948 after the landmark Supreme Court antitrust case, United States v. Paramount Pictures. The case decision broke up the studio system that had flourished since the birth of the industry by divesting movie studios of their ownership of theaters, which they had previously used to promote their own product and coerce independent theaters to subject themselves to block booking, a process that allowed the studios to sell product to said theaters under the condition that they also buy a set amount of other films sight unseen. Coupled with the advent of television, it crippled and almost completely destroyed the industry and forced the studios to experiment with various gimmicks and bills in a desperate bid to recoup their losses. Nicholson lost his job when the chain his theaters belonged to went out of business, and he ended up in the advertising department of Real Art Pictures, a distribution company founded by Jack Broder and Joseph Harris. Real Art began operations during the Universal International merger of the 1950s, which we discussed last time, when Universal head William Goetz saw little value in the studio's extensive catalog and leased its theatrical reissue rights to Broder and Harris. The duo packaged these films, most visibly the classic monster franchises, as double bills with bombastic and occasionally deceptive advertising campaigns and frequently new and salacious titles devised by Nicholson, which capitalized on the trends of the day. British B-level writer-producer Alex Gordon threatened Real Art with a lawsuit over a title similarity between one of these reissues and a script Gordon had written for Ed Wood to direct, The Atomic Monster. It was eventually released as Bride of the Monster, featured in MST3K's 4th season. Gordon's lawyer was a man named Samuel Z. Arkoff, who became fast friends with Nicholson during the tenuous process, which quickly cooled, and in 1954, Arkoff and Nicholson formed a distribution company out of Arkoff's home, American Releasing Company, or ARC, a name that was only chosen because American International was taken. This was around the time of the emergence of drive-in theaters and a boom in adolescents, who would be rebranded as teenagers in a few years' time, with access to cars and a desire to assert independence from the previous generation. Sidebar. I was born around the time of the rise of the multiplex, and by the time I became a full-fledged film junkie, drive-ins were all but dead. I missed out on a culture that seems magical in retrospect, and it stings. End sidebar. Nicholson had his finger on the pulse of the youth movement, and together with Arkoff's knack for business savvy, set out to find the perfect first original film for ARC that would appeal to this underserved demographic. They met Roger Corman, who agreed to make 1955's The Fast and the Furious for them in exchange for an advance, which Corman would use to make two other films. Fast and the Furious was a large success for the minimal investment, and ARC was officially an independent distributor with a specific market. In 1956, the previous American International went out of business, and Nicholson and Arkoff acquired the name. This new American International Pictures quickly grew tired of revolving solely around distribution and producing the bottom half of double bills. Since they collected only half the theatrical receipts, they made the conscious decision to independently produce both halves of their own double bill. Their process for creating product was simple. Come up with a catchy title, create a poster or other advertising art that caught the eye and imagination, even if it didn't totally line up with the finished product, listen to the actual exhibitors, and produce the most popular concepts based on their feedback. Or they would see a popular blockbuster, extrapolate the concept, make it hipper and younger, and rip it off. Both approaches worked equally well. AIP took note of producer Sam Katzman's 1956 film Rock Around the Clock, which exploited the burgeoning trend of rock and roll and the outcry it inspired from conservative parents, and quickly produced and released their own knockoff that was sympathetic to the young protagonists. This became a crucial theme of the company, not taking the material seriously and almost always taking the kids' side, even when it was irresponsible, because they were the ones buying tickets and the studios short-sightedly treated them as a lesser class. They naturally branched into producing horror and monster movies, which AIP molded in their own image, taking the position of power away from the adults and making the monsters young, hip, and hormonal, reclaiming vampires, werewolves, and even Frankenstein as teens. Nicholson, who already had a great cultural radar, had his skills amplified by his daughters, who were of the proper age and had more youthful insight. Such prophetic capitalization quickly became a double-edged sword, as Nicholson and Arkoff were revered in the industry for being smart and profitable, but derided for making a product that the studios deemed inferior. Before the decade was out, they had established not one but three production arms, the first led by Corman, the second by Alex Gordon, who teamed up with Arkoff's screenwriter brother-in-law Lou Rosoff, and the third by Herman Cohen, who scored big with I Was a Teenage Werewolf, which we'll discuss at the end of this episode. The relationships between Arkoff, Nicholson, and the three producers was a symbiotic one, and lasted for around a decade. With greater success and large profit margins, AIP began reaching out to filmmakers outside of their traditional scope, like master of the unconvincing miniature Bird Eye Gordon, and acquiring films from outside producers, like The Screaming Skull, which was riffed as the finale of MST3K's ninth season. But as the 60s approached, AIP found itself at a crucial point. Other independent companies and some of the smaller studios attempted to replicate their double bill strategy, and Hammer Films was delivering monster movies to the same demographic, in color, with vivid gore, which AIP could not afford to match. They began spending more and earning less, and eventually had to downgrade/upgrade to single bill attractions, co-financed to afford color and photographic gimmicks, shut down most production arms, and import sword and sandal pictures from overseas. In the new decade, Corman brought in a more sophisticated audience with a run of films very loosely based on the works of Edgar Allan Poe, the first of which, House of Usher, was a tremendous success and paved the way for increased production value. They also changed with the youth of the times and helped launch a new subgenre, the beach party musical, based on the popular trend of surfing and the success of studio films like Gidget, and booked Frankie Avalon and Annette Funicello to anchor their slate, starting with 1963's cleverly titled Beach Party.
We got an early start.
We're gonna have a ball.
We're gonna ride the surf.
And that ain't all. Nothing is greater than the sand serpents out there. Unwrap their boards just as soon as we get there. Stack them in the sand while they're breaking just right. Yeah, we're surfing all day and we're swinging all night. Vacation is here. Beach party tonight.
3 years later, they launched another subgenre, the biker film, starting with The Wild Angels, which starred Peter Fonda.
Yeah, we don't want nobody telling us what to do. We don't want nobody pushing us around.
I apologize. But tell me, just what is it that you want to do?
Well, we want to be free. We want to be free to do what we want to do. We want to be free to ride and... We want to be free to ride our machines without being hassled by the man. Yeah. And we want to get loaded.
Yeah.
And we want to have a good time.
Next was a run of quote-unquote protest films like The Trip and Gas, both of which were directed by Corman and both of which were meddled with in post-production by Nicholson and Arkoff, which eventually severed the working relationship between the three. AIP was considered a training ground for talent, although most of that talent was acquired through the association with Corman. They blew the chance to make it to the big leagues by passing on financing Easy Rider because of certain controversial story elements, and that film went on to be a freak success and one of the defining cultural events of the decade. In 1969, on Arkoff's decision, the company went public to raise extra capital, which Arkoff later declared was a disastrous move. Nicholson began to lose interest because he appreciated the purity of making movies without accountability and was uncomfortable having to answer to any form of authority, which Arkoff encouraged at the time. In 1972, Nicholson left to form Academy Pictures Releases, which had a distribution deal with 20th Century Fox, but was diagnosed with a brain tumor and died before any of his films in development went into production. Arkoff stayed with AIP until 1979, when he sold the company to Filmways for $30 million, then moved on to form Arkoff International Pictures, only producing four films over half a decade. He also went about diminishing Nicholson's legacy by downplaying his creative input in AIP's success in retrospective interviews and promotional appearances, which culminated in Nicholson being best remembered as a quote-unquote title man at best. In fact, and I did not know this until I saw Daniel Griffith's superb documentary on AIP, when you Google Nicholson's name, a picture of Arkoff comes up. All things being cyclical, Nicholson, and I guess Arkoff, were more prophetic than they've ever been given credit for. Today's crowded film marketplace is desperately hip, obsessed with a different form of exploitation, the intellectual property. Major studios build their entire release schedules around something with instant brand recognition that they can sell before shooting a frame of footage. They're AIP with resources and larger demographics. Given enough time, all independent flair eventually becomes mainstream. Harvey Weinstein and Miramax are proof of this. There's probably other non-rapists that apply, but he's the most visible example. AIP was also responsible for more MST3K experiments than any other studio or distributor, even continuing into the Netflix revival. So let's discuss four in particular. We start with Experiment 806, 1957's The Undead.
Unchain yourself from this world. Join Richard Garland, Pamela Duncan, Allison Hayes in the weird world of the undead. Where a witch of a wench gives free play to her unbridled passions and jealousies.
I could not tell you before, but now because I love thee, because I must help thee, I am a witch.
Witch?
I am thy match, witch.
You will make me a fine opponent.
Know the unearthly horror of untimely death. Face burial alive by the unfrocked monk who makes merry jests while burying the undead. See the tortured undulations of the unwanted virgins. Experience the unbelievable.
Ha ha ha! The Undead is our first run-in with Roger Corman since Season 7's premiere, Night of the Blood Beast, which he produced with his brother Gene, and Deathstalker 3, which was distributed by New Horizons, the company he founded after parting ways with Nicholson and Arkoff. It's also the first movie he directed since Season 5's Gunslinger, one of the very first productions of his to be produced by A.I.P., and it was written by fellow Nicholson and Arkoff mainstays Mark Hanna, who also co-wrote Gunslinger in addition to Season 3's The Amazing Colossal Man for Bird Eye Gordon, and Charles B. Griffith. Griffith may possess more AIP credits than any other screenwriter, like Season 3's It Conquered the World, Bucket of Blood, which we discussed in our Corman anthology in Chapter 6, the aforementioned Wild Angels, and because everyone involved with the undead is apparently connected to it, you guessed it, Gunslinger. The cast is a who's who of minor B-movie actors, from star Pamela Duncan, who headlined another Corman-directed Charles Griffith-written movie, Attack of the Crab Monsters, that very same year, and Richard Garland, also in Crab Monsters and the ex-husband of Beverly Garland, Corman's longtime leading lady and, of course, star of Gunslinger, to Allison Hayes, Attack of the 50-Foot Woman's titular protagonist and co-star of Season 1's The Crawling Hand, Mel Wells, another Corman regular, best known for his role as Mr. Mushnick in the original Little Shop of Horrors and co-star of Jack Arnold's High School Confidential, and legendary dwarf actor Billy Barty. Ms. Duncan plays Diana Love, a woman of the night, a colorful euphemism for old-timey sex worker, who provides her services to the American Institute for Psychical Research, which, being that this is a Roger Corman movie, predictably looks, well, unclean.
Dirty, greasy walls, a short-lived design fad.
I don't think I want to be hypnotized.
At the Institute, Quintus Ratcliffe, presumably a villain in a Disney cartoon, judging by the name, requests that his former teacher, Professor Olinger, put Diana under hypnosis so that she may access her previous lives for some reason. Yes, reincarnation is real, and only people who operate out of oily, stained offices can crack the code. The professor successfully places Diana in a trance, and soon she awakens in a dungeon in the Middle Ages, except now she answers to the name Helene. Helene learns that she has been imprisoned to face execution by beheading for the crimes of being a witch. She escapes the dungeon and is chased around by a knight named Pendragon, played by Richard Garland, in what looks like 15 feet of brushland, probably less, as the movie was shot in 7 days in a former supermarket. Helene encounters a gravedigger named Smolkin, played by Mel Wells, and hides in a coffin inside his hearse while Pendragon interrogates him regarding Helene's whereabouts.
The witch Helene has escaped from the Tower of Death. Have you seen her?
Helene? The damsel they say did bewitch me. Nay, I have not seen her.
What is in thy hearse?
The knight from Muncie.
None but a lonely corpse I take to bury. For his own good, he'd best be dead.
Open thy wagon.
Pull us thy vehicle to the curb and show us me thy driver's license and registration. Did thou knowest how fast thou was driving?
Pendragon pisses off and we meet Livia, Allison Hayes, and her constantly mincing imp, Billy Barty, two magical beings who have the ability to shapeshift into lizards, owls, bats, a black cat, and other props left over from other Corman movies. Why? Not really sure. Don't really care.
She may be this way until the end of her life.
Which one?
Get it? Which one?
Kill him.
It's okay. It's Corman.
As Livia is off strutting around and changing into things that provide her no decipherable benefit, Smolkin attempts to bury the coffin Helene is hiding in, but hears a woman's voice call from within and lets her out. Helene insists that she wasn't bewitching him and asks him to hide her for 1 day so that she can have a year to make her case of innocence somehow. He agrees and takes her to safety. Suddenly we cut back to the present day as Diana awakens and explains to Quintus and the professor that she will die soon because she has altered the past. The professor notices a bruise on her forearm and Quintus determines her past life regression to be both mental and physical. If she can't go back to the Middle Ages and forfeit her life as Helene, her successive past lives will never come to pass, including her life as Diana. They hook her back under...
And yet I feel I'm the cause of it all.
Nay, not the cause, Helene. The victim.
All right, but who's the witch?
If there be someone here with vital speech to tell, let them give tongue.
Whoa.
Or scurry to his cave.
I shall give tongue, Pendragon, hear me out. And check the fury that must rise in thee till I have finished.
Yeah, Corman's a good director.
Uh-huh. Helene is confronted by the rabble of supporting players and given the chance to decide her fate once and for all. Live this past life to an uncertain future, or die and assure the lives to come. In what is probably the only effective moment in the movie, everyone screams their choices at her, including her own future selves.
Pray die, Helene. Wake and be a wretched trollop. Methinks it would be better to escape this age of misery.
Helene, stay with me.
Take the death! Take the death!
Change the curtain.
Death!
No, the curtain runs out.
Stay, Helene.
Go! Stay!
Stop the movie! Stay!
Again and again throughout uncounted ages.
Wow.
Stay!
I live this lifetime now.
Helene decides to die and defers to a headsman, who presumably does his job by taking hers. Diana awakens in the present day and vows to live a better life, pretty judgmental. But where present-day Quintus once stood, only his clothes remain. Instead, his physical body remains in the past, as his link to the future was with Helene. With her past self dead, he's stuck here with Satan, and the two of them laugh like a couple of hyenas. The end.
It can come from none of thee.
I've never known more about what isn't going on in the movie.
For me, The Undead marks the first time in Season 8 that the series and the available experiment were perfectly calibrated. The Universal International movies could be dreadfully dull and far more professional than I believe the Best Brains crew were accustomed to, although they provide a nice bridge between the fodder of MST3K and the typical target of the early days of riff tracks. The Undead episode is mostly devoted to continuing the introduction of the Observers and the brief time that Servo spent in their ranks, but also has a few host segments tuned to the experiment to enjoy. The first involves Bridget Nelson playing Livia, the randomly shapeshifting witch, who, as it turns out, is really bad at accessing her polymorphic powers.
Whoa!
Who hath summoned me?
Well, I don't think that I did. Did you guys?
I don't think so.
Not that I recall.
Well, someone has brought me here from the realm of the unknown, and I intend to... Uh-oh.
Uh-oh.
Whoa.
Whoa. Didn't mean to do that. Because I have terrible dark powers, sure which I intend to... Oh, cripes!
What? There you go again.
Never been a football before.
Yeah, that was cool.
What the heck is going on here?
Ma'am, do you need a glass of water?
Yeah. Yes, you know. No, I want your very souls and oh boy.
Oh.
Oh. Wind? Ah.
Trying my best. Just a little bit rusty.
Sure,
I'm
takes it out
fine.
Of you.
It's just, oh boy.
Whoa.
My favorite bit, however, comes at episode's end. It involves Crow impersonating Billy Barty's imp and Servo's aggravation at discovering that esteemed Entertainment Tonight film critic Leonard Maltin awarded The Undead 3 stars. It's even meaner than their takedown of his movie guide during the closing credits of Laser Blast. But to be fair, everything you're about to hear is earned.
Hey, Crow, how's the imping going?
Fairly successfully, I think. And you?
Pretty good.
Hello, Mike. Imp.
Hi, I'm an imp.
Hi, Servo.
Hi. Hey, Mike, did you know that Leonard Maltin gave The Undead 3 stars? Huh? Did you know that? Did you?
No, actually, I didn't know that.
Oh, that's too bad. Hey, do me a favor. Grab the stuff from under the desk, will you? Well, there's a beard down there and some glasses, and just slap those on, will you?
Put them on? Oh, okay.
You're doing me a big favor.
Don't really understand, but sure.
There we go. Okay. That's it. Now the glasses. That's
all right.
It. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Now you're Leonard Maltin, see?
Yeah,
now read the script under there, will you?
Oh,
I'm
sure.
An imp.
Read it like you mean it. Do the voice, too.
Oh, okay. I, Leonard Maltin, is that okay? Do hereby acknowledge that I was completely out of my mind in awarding 3 stars to the Roger Corman film, The Undead.
Yeah, good, that's fine. What the hell were you thinking, you stupid bearded man?
I'm an imp.
My opinion bears no merit whatsoever, and I promise a full and complete refund to all who have purchased my horribly wayward and grossly inaccurate video guide.
Yes,
I renounce myself and all I stand for.
Yes, that's it. Go on!
I have been to the proletariat areas and have consorted with the prostitutes. Now that seems a little below the belt there.
One wonders if Maltin saw this bit before or after he agreed to appear as himself in the book and host segments for Season 9's Gorgo, especially considering the whole consorting with prostitutes part. Up next, Experiment 806, 1958's Terror from the Year 5000.
What weird creature fills the night with strange and mystifying terror?
It's our theory that we've penetrated the time barrier. We're the first explorers of the actual future.
Two men, brought together by science, torn apart by a woman unwilling to hurt the man who loves her. Unable to resist the other. two men defying unknown terrors to project the mind and lives of men into the future. Terror from the year 5000. Terror that mesmerizes, paralyzes a man's mind.
When our scientists realized that your device had penetrated the time barrier, I was selected to come and lead you into our world of the future. You must come with me.
Victor, what are you doing?
I'm going into the future.
You don't know what you're saying. You're ill. You should be...
No, I must come.
Leave him alone.
You'll know terror that breaks the sound barrier, the light barrier, the time barrier, when you see... Terror from the year 5000.
Terror from the year 5000 comes from writer-director Robert Gurney Jr., who began his career with the screenplay for Invasion of the Saucer Men, the first AIP sci-fi movie to feature a teenage protagonist, and then bowed out of the industry after co-writing Season 4's Attack of the Eye Creatures, uncredited. Gurney adapted a short story by sci-fi author and longtime Alfred Hitchcock Presents contributor Henry Sleaser, a man TV Guide once declared the writer with the largest audience in America. Gurney was assisted by his wife, Beatrice Ferdow, who worked as co-production designer, production supervisor, and also had a supporting role, and assistant editor Dee Dee Allen, who went on to edit Robert Wise's Odds Against Tomorrow the next year, and eventually received 3 Academy Award nominations, in addition to being the second most featured artist on the Motion Picture Editors Guild list of the 75 best edited films of all time for Bonnie and Clyde, Dog Day Afternoon, and Reds, respectively. The cast features Ward Costello, best known for minor series television roles and having composed the theme for Robert Montgomery's The Gallant Hours, a film I've never heard of, and Joyce Holden, who began as a Universal International regular, even starring in Jack Arnold's Girls of the Night, and retired from acting mere weeks after the release of Terror. John Stratton, the original Captain Potter from a series we discussed in one of the Chronicles Revisited bonus episodes, Quatermass in the Pit, Frederick Downs, familiar to Misty's as the chemist in Skydivers that Susie sleeps with in exchange for acid, and Salome Jones, a regular on Mary Hartman, Mary Hartman, and the female changeling from Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
In the year 1958, man launched the first satellite and pierced the space barrier.
And yet I can't get my pants back by Thursday.
Now, in an isolated area of central Florida, man struggles to penetrate the most imposing barrier of all.
Dames!
The time barrier. Here, Professor Howard Erling, nuclear physicist, probes relentlessly into the future, only to unleash upon the world terror from the year 5000.
Are you ready for terror?
Two scientists in a Floridian estate with greasy stained walls, obviously, build a machine to break the temporal barrier, which is basically a water heater slash cryogenic chamber hooked up to an electrical super slinky. They do this so that they can trade objects through time. Their latest find? A radioactive statuette from the year 5200 AD. One of the scientists thinks that their efforts have the potential for disaster, and the other wants to keep plugging away in the hopes of bringing back a living specimen. Sounds exciting, no?
I suppose you're wondering when the terror from the year 5000 will show up. Well, my apologies, it is taking rather long, but we're trying to pace ourselves.
The more shady of the two scientists increases the nuclear power used to activate the machine while working alone and is grabbed by some unknown human form, causing his arm to be severely radioactively burned. The shady scientist is taken to the hospital, and while waiting for the doctors to examine his burns, his daughter and a consulting archaeologist decide to take in a double feature of AIP movies at the local theater, including a film that will come up again later, I Was a Teenage Frankenstein.
Now, don't get excited. Nothing to do but wait. Is there a good movie in town?
Now we get to watch people watching a movie? What is that all about?
Boy. Without being observed, the shady scientist immediately flees the hospital and breaks into the lab to continue his experiments without interference. He increases the power even further and is attacked by the same human form, which turns out to be a mutant woman from the year 5000. Terror, if you will. She escapes, kills a nurse, peels off that nurse's face, and uses it as her own. While in disguise, she convinces the scientist who brought her to this time to come back with her to the future, where his healthy genes are needed to save her people from extinction. They activate the machine together, but are thwarted at the last minute by cooler heads and accidentally electrocuted, dying as a result. The surviving characters soberly acknowledge that by changing the present, they can avoid a future atomic holocaust. Exactly how they're going to change the present is not dwelled on, nor does it matter. The moral of this story? Don't break the time barrier. Nothing but heartache will follow. And radioactive mutant ladies, that too. The Terror from the Year 5000 episode is one of the best of the season, thanks to an incredibly varied assortment of host segments. Story arc-wise, we're still stuck on Observer World, and the albino aliens in question get the chance to demonstrate their musical prowess. Mike Nelson's Observer, with Paul Chaplin and Bill Corbett's soon-to-be crucial brain guy doing backup, lip-syncs another tremendous Kevin Murphy vocal, the lovely and frankly rather gross When I Held Your Brain in My Arms.
There was a time so bright and gay, it seems like only yesterday, when I held your brain in my arms.
The nanites whip up a time machine that looks spot-on accurate to the one in the experiment, and Mike sends Crow on a crucial mission through the time barrier to encounter the Nelson family in Wisconsin 1997 and inform them of their son's grave interstellar peril. Crow, in almost typical fashion, gets a little sidetracked.
Goodbye, Aunt Edna, you kook! Oh, Mike! Your family, they are good people.
Yeah, so did you see him? Did you tell him what happened? Did you tell him I'm okay?
Oh, shoot. Darn, I knew there was something I was supposed to do. Darn it! See, there was this 4th of July party my third summer there where I almost
told him... Wait, third summer?
Yeah, before college. I was kind of...
Well, how long were you there?
11 years. You see, Mike, in time travel, you can live a whole lifetime in a single second. And boy, did I live! Woo, baby.
Well, did they ask about me? Did they miss me at all?
Yeah, I'm sure they did. Hey, your dad, a kook man. I'm telling you, grab those pictures out of the time machine, would you?
Well, my dad's pretty reserved, I find.
Elmer Keg Drainer Nelson? Reserved? I don't think so. What else did you grow up in? Hey, and speaking of, I busted your stereo. Sorry about that. I knew you wouldn't mind.
Oh, okay.
Oh, that's a good one. Put that on still stereo.
Oh, all right. Yeah.
See, me and your dad, we stayed up like 3 days.
What is this?
Oh, put that next one up.
Dad doesn't party.
We're doing the bunny hop at that little place on the French side of St. Martin. Oh, and there's the one with Smitty and Murph. Smitty and Murph. Oh, which reminds me, Smitty and Murph, we rolled your charger. Totaled it. I knew you wouldn't mind.
Hey, Crow, I almost hate to ask. Is that my old girlfriend, Ginger?
You mean Ginger Snap?
No.
Oh, and there's one with Ginger and me at Stuart Anderson's Cattle Company.
Every description of this host segment that I've ever read states simply that Crow quote-unquote hits on Mike's girlfriend. But based on Crow's inflection, I like to believe that he got much further than that. I have problems. After the experiment is finished, Mike retaliates for this indiscretion by using the time machine to score Crow a date.
Whoa, get away from me! Get away from me! Oh, Mike, that is rich. I guess I need a little lesson.
Oh, that's great.
So, where to, sweetie? Perkins it is, then. Bread bowl salads for two.
That's actually prop diva Bees McKeever as the Terror from the Year 5000, her first official character after having played a focus group participant during The Incredible Melting Man and a singing mutant in The Deadly Mantis. She would go on to be the new magic voice just a few episodes later and play her most memorable part, Steffi the Babysitter, in Season 9. Next up, Experiment 808, 1956's The She-Creature.
Brought to screen life by Chester Morris, Marla English, Kathy Downs, Lance Fuller, Tom Conway, Frieda Innescourt, and Ron Randall. It's an adventure into the occult, such as few people have known, and only those who see it can believe.
You're not going for that supernatural hokum of his.
I don't really know what I'm going for. I know he's a killer.
Now you are traveling back through time and space. Farther. Farther back. Back.
Under his spell, she was both herself and another being. The she-creature seeking life sustenance from the stolen heartbeats of others. She was a woman born to be loved. And two men wanted her. One, a man whose powerful mad mind controlled her every reflex except her love.
No!
The other, willing to fight any odds for her love.
You've been living in shadows. I want to bring you back to life.
Society dances to hide the hysterical terror caused by their sudden intimacy with death. Forever closer comes the she-creature. You'll never forget.
She-creature director Edward L. Kahn got his start directing R-Gang shorts for Hal Roach before transitioning to low-budget exploitation work in the mid-50s with The Creature with the Atom Brain, Girls in Prison, It, The Terror from Beyond Space, and of course Invasion of the Saucer Men. The script came from Lou Russoff, Sam Arkoff's brother-in-law and a key Corman collaborator, with Alex Gordon producing, and a creature costume designed by AIP mainstay Paul Blaisdell, who was also responsible for the monsters of It Conquered the World, From Hell It Came, a random recommendation from Mary Jo Peel that was considered for MST3K in Season 7, Season 3's Earth vs. the Spider, and Season 4's Teenagers from Outer Space. The cast was headlined by Chester Morris, the second-to-last screen performance for the Academy Award nominee and titular star of the Boston Blackie detective film series. His co-stars included Lance Fuller, longtime Universal International contract player, appearing as Brack in This Island Earth and Jack Arnold's The Glass Web, and Tom Conway, a Val Luton regular who played Dr. Orloff in Season 5's finale, 12 to the Moon. The female lead, Kathy Downs, previously starred in My Darling Clementine before having her career tragically and abruptly curbed for not accepting the sexual advances of Fox chief Daryl Zanuck, spending the next decade working for Poverty Row Studios and the rest of her life unemployed. So kudos to AIP for giving her at least some work. Morris played Carnival Sideshow hypnotist Dr. Carlo Lombardi, the poor man's constipated Stacy Keach, and a man with resting outraged face.
This is scary. I'm not going to get any sleep tonight.
And the occult world notwithstanding, I think I'll take you downtown and wait till the reports come in.
Well, I can tell you what the reports will say.
They'll say, sleep!
But no living thing killed them.
Dr. Lombardi is scorned by the scientific community, but tenuously appreciated by high society well-to-dos. He uses his quote-unquote gifts to regress patients so that they can remember their past lives and claims that said past lives can actually manifest in physical form. How? Science!
Well, haven't you left yet?
He's lumped them all together. Hypnotism, spiritualism, age regression, reincarnation, and soul transmigration.
Soul!
He's doing quite a selling job.
Soul transmigration.
In fact, he's been regressing one woman in particular, Andrea Talbot, who was a sea creature in a past life, and uses the power of suggestion to put Andrea under a love spell and use the manifested past life sea creature to murder his enemies. Chief among the high society muckety-mucks in awe of Lombardi's skills is Timothy Chappell, who puts aside his suspicion of Lombardi's involvement in the previously mentioned murders to enter a mutual business arrangement with the bad doctor, which pays off when Lombardi demonstrates his hold on Andrea for some professionals, and the ensuing story sells millions of books. Mr. Chappell has an exaggeratedly Swedish butler, Olaf, who serves as the much-needed, poorly delivered comic relief at various points in the story.
Works every time.
Oh, that dog. Hickus smitty jitters. I get a nervous Adam's apple and that makes my tie jump off.
Inspired by Balky.
Morning, Ted. Dorothy will be down in a minute.
Dorothy dead. I killed her.
Certainly not too popular with that member of your family. Take him to the kitchen and get him something to eat, huh?
The last time I took him to the kitchen, he knee-eat up the cook.
Thank you very much. What's so stupid?
Come on, dog.
My poopies is pee-pee.
His irritating nature stirs up a particularly hateful scorn courtesy of Crow, who takes every opportunity to hurl outdated anti-Scandinavian slurs at him, which I didn't realize were considered offensive until I'd started doing research for this episode.
You're a dumb squarehead like this guy, aren't you, Mike?
Actually, that's just my dad's.
That fellow Bob, he's as drunk as a lumberjack. Yeah, he drinks like a fish. Yeah, but not the same stuff. Say, my Pete's poop just keeping him filled up.
Pete's his poop. For 18 years, I tried to teach you how to speak good American.
Well, I speak just as good broken American as you do.
Lice.
Pete's his poop.
All right, then my foot says peep. The cook says it comes out of the ocean. It's tall like a building, and it has got the arms like a pile driver.
I am not afraid. For 18 years, I'm married to you. Nothing scares me anymore.
I'm a stupid squarehead.
Lieutenant James, at the front door.
Oh?
Go cream some fish, you squarehead!
For every person that allies with Lombardi, like Mr. Chapel, there is somebody to antagonize and question his motives and practices, like Mr. Chapel's daughter's boyfriend, Dr. Ted Erickson, played by Lance Fuller. Ted is always on Lombardi like white on rice, the skeptic that seeks to expose him as responsible for the sea monster murders that Mr. Chapel seems to tolerate and declare him a fraud during demonstrations.
All homosexuals to the stage, please. I'm kidding.
Eventually, Ted and the police get hip to Lombardi's misdeeds and foil his attempt to use Andrea's sea creature past life construct to murder them. Lombardi's hold over Andrea weakens, and Andrea briefly connects with the creature independently and sicks it on her abuser. Lombardi dies as his hold is completely broken, and Andrea's first act as a free woman is to direct the creature into the sea where it belongs, the sea of the present, not the past. The end. The she creature was inspired by a very popular book about hypnotism in past lives, The Search for Bridie Murphy, which was also the inspiration for Corman's The Undead. Unlike The Undead, however, the she-creature took secondary inspiration in the success of Creature from the Black Lagoon, two great tastes that taste wrong together. And despite the magnetic power of Chester Morris's lead performance, he was not the first man intended for the part. Character actor Edward Arnold was cast as Dr. Carlo Lombardi, but died 2 days before the start of production. Peter Lorre, also cast in a supporting role, was inspired by Arnold's death to read the script his agent signed him up for sight unseen, and quickly left the production in addition to firing that agent. Producer Alex Gordon had to scramble at the last minute to find a replacement cast, as well as provide the remaining $40,000 of a $104,000 budget that AIP could not afford, which he obtained through a financier friend of his brother. The she-creature also sent me on quite the enjoyable detour thanks to a relatively obscure reference.
Jaime's pissed.
Let's go back to the swinging mid-60s and discuss the spy spoof to end all spy spoofs, and by association, a humanoid robot. Get smart. In early 1965, two soon-to-be legends, Mel Brooks, the future director of Blazing Saddles and Young Frankenstein, and the late Buck Henry, future screenwriter of The Graduate, To Die For, Heaven Can Wait, and Catch-22, teamed up for a televised pantsing of both traditional sitcoms of the era and the burgeoning cinematic phenomenon of James Bond. The result? A half-hour of perfectly calibrated absurdity centering around two battling counterintelligence agencies, the valorous Control and the nefarious Chaos. Control's top man is Agent 86. Get it? Maxwell Smart, America's sharpest moron.
Max, you're just going to have to be more careful with Dr. Schottwire. Try and keep out of his way while you're guarding him. He says you've set back his work 6 months.
6 months? That's ridiculous. 3 months, 4 months tops.
Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Get Smart. John Adams, ace deadpan stand-up comedian and voice of Tennessee Tuxedo, starred as Smart, with Barbara Feldon as his love interest, eventual wife, and infinitely more competent partner, Agent 99, and Edward Platt as the beleaguered chief of Control. Smart frequently met put-upon colleagues in the field, like Agent 44, played by Victor French, who was always given the unenviable task of hiding in plain sight, usually inside large hollow objects like trees or a cuckoo clock.
Oh, I'm sorry, 86. I should have known you were right. It's just that I've been cooped up in so many clocks and lockers and glove compartments for so long. Nobody tells me anything. It isn't fair. I'm a good agent. I haven't been able to wear my tuxedo once. Not once. And who'd see it in the clock?
Don't get so emotional, 44. Here, you can have my book.
I couldn't do that.
Go ahead, take it. I've already memorized it.
86, I won't forget this.
You do the same thing for me. Now, buck up. I've got to get back to the party.
Maxwell Smart ranks among the greatest characters ever created for television. A man who takes his job dead seriously and only manages to succeed at it accidentally and despite his best efforts. He saw himself as a master of the poker face, even if it was clear to every villain he faced that he was terrible at bluffing.
And I happen to know that at this very minute, 7 Coast Guard cutters are converging on this boat. Would you believe it? 7.
I find that pretty hard to believe.
Would you believe 6?
I don't think so.
How about 2 cops on a rowboat?
You're stalling, Mr. Smart.
Where James Bond had sexy gadgets that were introduced flippantly and quickly dispatched, Agent 86 had more utilitarian tools of the trade, like a phone inside his shoe that he naturally had to remove to speak into. His adventures were more mundane than those Bond found himself on, usually dealing with chaos's bureaucracy of evil and always complying with the Control Rules and Regulations book. Each week, Smart would stumble upon truly fantastic feats of Cold War ingenuity, like Jaime the Robot, played by Dick Gaudier, a synthetic humanoid with enhanced strength and fluctuating programmability created by Chaos to eliminate him. Jaime was designed to appear in only 1 episode of the first season, but the audience reaction made him a recurring character after some swifty reprogramming. Unfortunately, for all his prowess, Jaime had insurmountable flaws, like a tendency to take things literally.
Seems to be stuck.
Yes. Jaime, give me a hand. Never mind, Jaime, come on.
Get Smart lasted for 5 seasons, 4 on NBC, 1 on CBS, and spawned dozens of offshoots and spin-offs. There was a comic book partially drawn by Steve Ditko, creator of The Question and Spider-Man, a theatrical film, The Nude Bomb, produced 10 years after the end of the series without the input of Brooks or Henry, a reunion TV movie that led to a sequel series in 1995 starring Adams and Felden in their original roles, and Andy Dick right before news radio as their bumbling secret agent's son, and a remake film with Steve Carell in the title role that I generously describe as, okay. Any show or film that dares to show the sillier side of espionage owes a debt of gratitude to Maxwell Smart and the other ladies and gentlemen of Control. We previously discussed how the 60s were a time of concept comedy, and Get Smart is no exception. It was better than we deserved, and as a result, we've been trying unsuccessfully to replicate it ever since.
Max, I don't like your plan. You could be killed.
Yes, I know, but we've got to flush that chaos infiltrator out into the open.
But you're deliberately setting yourself up as a target. You'll be in extreme danger every minute.
And loving it.
In the She Creature episode, Observer World goes boom thanks to an unfortunate turn of phrase that's 2 annihilated planets on Mike's red ledger for those counting at home, and some great self-contained host segments can be found therein. First off, Crow takes advantage of the Tickle Me Elmo mania that was sweeping the nation in 1997, proof that maybe, just maybe, our priorities were a little ridiculous in the 90s. He creates the Tickle Me Carlo Lombardi, which sounds like something one of my uncles probably would have gotten me for my birthday at the time. I'm not naming names.
It's my Tickle Me Carlo Lombardi doll.
Oh, wow, what the...
Yeah, it's just like the lovable Tickle Me Elmo doll, only it's Carlo Lombardi.
What, why?
Oh, that's a lot of little boys' initial reaction to dolls, but you'll grow to love it as you take it into your room, perhaps prop it next to your bed as you sleep. He'll watch over you. He's Dr. Carlo Lombardi.
Crow, why would you even
go
make
ahead,
a doll?
Go ahead, Mike. Tickle him.
No.
Oh, I think you'd better, Mike. Tickle me, Carlo Lombardi. Doesn't like to be disappointed.
Well, I just, you know, just to be safe. Okay.
That's right. Tickle me, Carlo Lombardi is your friend forever.
But the best segment is predicated on the discovery of an instructional book written by Lance Fuller, a.k.a. Dr. Ted Erickson, based on his perceived performance process as determined by the She Creature. It's called Do Not Act, and it's chock full of advice to avoid following.
Hey, I was wondering if you could help me out with a couple scenes. Sure. I got King Lear here.
Yeah, I've heard the Fuller method is perfect for the bard.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm the Duke of Albany then?
Right.
Okay. All friends shall taste the wages of their virtue, and all foes the cup of their deservings. Oh, see, oh, see.
My poor fool, Hank. No, no life at all. And why should a horse, a dog, a rat have life, and now none at all?
A little too much eye contact, yeah. Mike. Yeah. Listen to Lance here. Do not, under any circumstances, listen to your fellow actor. No. Simply wait till they've stopped talking.
Right, yeah, right. You know, I think I wasn't looking down at the floor enough.
Yeah, I think that's what it was. Yeah. Okay. Let's try a scene from The Odd Couple. This time, remember what Lance says here. At most, a mild and petulant show of incredulity, whatever the circumstances of the scene.
Got it. Okay,
this should be fun. I'm Felix. Here we go. It's not spaghetti. It's linguine. Linguine.
Now it's garbage.
Mm. No, just a little too much emotion.
Yeah.
Try network.
Okay. All right, I think I got it. I was mad as hell, and I'm not going to take it anymore.
Yeah. Not quite. Yeah. A little flatter, Mike. How about Schindler's List?
Okay, all right. I could have done more. Could have saved more people.
Okay, you've almost got it there. Okay, now try the scene from Waterworld. Now, you're Kevin Costner.
Kevin Costner.
Right,
you see your precious catamaran sinking into the ocean.
Yeah, right into the ocean.
And...
my boat.
Perfect. Yeah. That's it. Wonderful.
Money, baby.
Okay, got it. Thanks a lot for helping. We'll be right back.
Our last movie for the week is Experiment 809, 1957's I Was a Teenage Werewolf.
I know they're going to catch me, but don't let anyone see me like that. Please, doctor, help me.
Michael Landon in a powerful performance as the boy possessed. Yvonne Lyon appealing as the girl who loves him. Whit Bissell, unforgettable as the scientist maddened by the mystery of the werewolf. And Tony Marshall, a tough, friendly enemy.
These the official pictures?
Yes, Chief.
Slash on either side of the throat. You got any theories?
Fangs.
He was killed by a werewolf.
Panic penetrates every home when this strange, unknown killer hits town. Taking hold of the teenage crowd. Coloring their practical jokes with hysterical humor that'll make you fall flat on your face. With horror.
No. Remember how wonderful it was when you sprang and suddenly dug in with your fangs, a soft throat, a gush of warm blood?
No! No!
Nothing you've ever seen has such blood-chilling savagery. Nothing you've ever conceived packs such a spine-tingling jolt. This high school boy, a teenage werewolf. A constant threat of claw-ripping attack to everyone, to the brave and the beautiful.
As we discussed earlier in this episode, Teenage Werewolf was the brainchild of AIP's third-prong producer Herman Cohen, who also co-wrote the script with longtime collaborator Aben Candle, in addition to his producing duties. Gene Fowler Jr. made his directorial debut after a decade as editor to both Fritz Lang and Sam Fuller, a profession he returned to in the 60s, eventually editing It's a Mad, 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 Mad World, and Clint Eastwood's Hang 'Em High. Future television legend Michael Landon played the titular hormonal creature before becoming omnipresent in American culture with Bonanza and Little House on the Prairie, supported by character actor Whit Bissell, who also appeared in the original Invasion of the Body Snatchers and Creature from the Black Lagoon. Tony Rivers, played by Landon, is an awkward, sullen teen with anger issues who's constantly taking things too hard and getting into scrapes over trivial matters. In fact, we meet him in media res as he engages in a senseless slugfest with another student, which attracts the attention of a local detective.
Oh, Tony, you really ought to smile more often.
Sure. Win friends and charm snakes, huh?
That's just what I wanted to talk to you about.
Snakes.
Suspicious of everybody. Act like the whole world's your enemy the way you flare up.
Oh, people bug me.
That's right. Hide behind jive talk. People bug you. Well, people bug me, too. But I don't go around clouding everybody.
Come on. Finish your beep, will you?
All I know is you've been in trouble a half a dozen times.
That's
you don't have any official record yet, but you're sure working up to one.
Hit him! But you got a crystal ball, huh?
I've pulled you out of fights three times myself in the last month. You're just lucky there weren't any formal complaints. The time before this in the supermarket.
It was the checker's mistake.
Yeah, but you didn't even give him a chance to rectify it. Boom, you throw a carton of milk right at him.
It contained bovine growth hormone, and he turned into a giant cow.
Tony.
The detective recommends that he work with a quote-unquote psychologist and hypnotherapist, Dr. Brandon, played by Bissell, which Tony declines to do. After accidentally attacking one of his friends and being dressed down about his aggressive behavior by his girlfriend and widowed father, played by the same depressed widow father from Season 6's High School Big Shot, an experiment that is only slightly cheerier, Tony meets with Dr. Brandon as a last resort. Unfortunately, Dr. Brandon is more of a mad scientist than a psychologist and has come up with a serum of scopolamine that could potentially regress humans to their primitive instincts and injects it into a desperate Tony. What is it with regression and scientists these days?
What are you doing?
I'm going to mix the serum with the scopolamine.
Ogre cracked up.
Do you realize the possible consequences?
I realize one thing, that at last, after years of searching, I found a suitable person for my experiment. His record at school, what the school principal told me, what I learned from Detective Sergeant Donovan, gives him the proper, disturbed, emotional background I need.
I want pudding.
What I found out from the physical examination, this boy is my perfect subject.
He has bonds of steel.
There were certain telltale marks on his body only I would recognize.
But you know what might happen.
Might. In science, one must be sure.
Even movie science.
I'm going to take this out of the realm of possibilities. Into the world of exact science. If I'm successful, then I can be certain.
But you're sacrificing a human life.
Do you cry over a guinea pig?
If it's Snowball.
This boy's a free police case. We're probably saving him from the gas chamber.
The boy's so young and the transformation horrible.
Another huge face.
You call yourself a scientist. That's why you've never been more than an assistant. But if you interfere, if you say one word...
No, Alfred. You can trust me.
Weak.
Yes, I know that. You've been more than an assistant on other occasions. Accomplice would be a better word.
Here, try that. You'll kiss God.
Soon, Tony's friends are dying in a brutal fashion, and the police station janitor believes that they are the victims of werewolf attacks. Tony becomes increasingly aware of his own loss of control and begs Dr. Brandon to help him with his deteriorating situation, which Dr. Gaslight, Dr. Brandon, disingenuously dismisses.
There's something I have to tell you.
And just chewed up your slippers.
I don't know if it really happened. It's more like a nightmare.
You've dated before.
Now, Tony.
Shut up.
Very often in psychotherapy, strange things seem to happen.
Because you're crazy.
Sometimes when we light up the dark corner of the human mind...
Doctor!
You're out of red books in the waiting room.
Doctor, please help me.
And do exactly as I say. All I can tell you is that your progress is excellent. I've even told the principal of your school that. Yes, I'm extremely pleased with the progress you've been making. And soon, Tony, very soon...
We'll be married.
You'll be your true self again.
Boy, you'll be a werewolf soon.
Cool, he's got the Keith Richards signature syringe.
And after this, we'll go out for a nice naked lunch.
Later that day, after discussing college admissions with his principal, Tony passes through the gym and is startled by a school bell that causes him to transform into a werewolf, though he looks more like Chewbacca's son Lumpy from the Star Wars Holiday Special. He attacks and kills a gymnast and flees the scene. The police issue an APB for his arrest, and he stalks around the town doing what werewolves typically do, knocking glass objects off of countertops and foaming severely at the mouth. Tony awakens the next day in human form and seeks the aid of Dr. Gaslight, who instead wants to inject the poor kid again and film it in the interest of furthering his own quote-unquote scientific pursuits. His werewolf side is activated by a ringing phone, and Tony kills Dr. Gaslight and his assistant before meeting the business end of a shit ton of policeman-generated bullets and transforms back into his human form as he breathes his last.
It's not for man to interfere in the ways of God.
No? Remember, only get injections and past life regressions by licensed mad psychiatrists.
As I alluded to earlier, I Was a Teenage Werewolf was a substantial hit, grossing around $2 million on a budget of $82,000. I will say that while I don't think it's a very good film, Landon delivers a very intense performance, and the filmmakers have a very clear sense of tone and take the material and the target audience very seriously, even if they don't seem to understand how either truly works. And bonus points for actually attempting a clever metaphor with the correlation between irrational hormones and lupine passion. Being the first movie to use the word teenage in the title, it inspired A.I.P. and producer Herman Cohen that they had a good thing going, and within 4 months, I Was a Teenage Frankenstein was in theaters, also starring Whit Bissell as practically the same character, an unassuming madman who uses the power of science to experiment with the body of an adolescent. 4 months after that, A.I.P. basically remade I Was a Teenage Werewolf beat for beat, substituting a female vampire for the male werewolf as Blood of Dracula. In 1958, Teenage Werewolf and Teenage Frankenstein met in the meta-crossover-slash-sequel How to Make a Monster, which shared a double bill theatrically with Season 3 experiment Teenage Caveman and began the AIP cinematic universe. It also made significant inroads in popular culture, becoming the object of parody in a later season episode of SCTV, which combined the concept with a send-up of Red Scare propaganda in a sketch called I Was a Teenage Communist.
Operator, get me the police!
Stay cool. I Was a Teenage Communist will continue after these messages.
And that is where we end this act of the Coolness Chronicles. Next week is our Patreon-exclusive bonus episode. The season finale of the Coolness Chronicles goes to the movies. All about Jon Favreau's dazzlingly empty remake of The Lion King. Patreon.com/CoolnessChronicles. But 2 weeks from today, we'll continue our deep dive into MST3K's 8th season, and now that everyone is properly calibrated, the experiments get exponentially better from here. Arachnids that look suspiciously like Volkswagen Beetles terrorize soggy Wisconsinites, Michael Bay duplicates the saga of a clone facility, Torgo surrogate Ortega arrives, and Crow and Servo engage in some disturbing dog and bear role-playing. All that and much, much more as we continue to chart the history and legacy of Mystery Science Theater 3000.
It may be time to end this, observers.
Shall I schedule the dissections?
Excellent idea, observer.
Thank you, observer. And you too, observer. Tune in next week.
Observe your local listings.
Thank you to everyone involved in making MST3K for everything they've contributed to my life and to culture as a whole. Double thanks for writing the episode guide that I will quote frequently in this season of the pod. I also want to thank Shout Factory for their excellent supplemental material that was invaluable to my research for this and every episode to follow on this subject. Double thanks to Daniel Griffith for his documentary on AIP that informed the top half of this episode. If you want to support the artist who made this wonderful show, many episodes are available on VOD at rifftracks.com. And thank you for listening. If you enjoy what you hear, please rate and review the show on iTunes or your chosen source, and share it with anyone you can, any way you can. This has been the largest and most fulfilling endeavor I've ever seen to completion, and it would be nice to keep making the show until it just isn't fun anymore. Have questions or comments, want to be on the show, or is there anything I missed in this particular chapter? Contact me on Twitter at CoolnessPodRyan or on our Facebook page, and keep on the lookout for updates. Special thanks to our amazing patrons Bill M., Christopher H., Christopher J., Tracy R., Zach F., and Jenny R. Until next time, do what you love, don't be a dick. And as always,
Riff Tracks fans do not care about cockney rhyming slang.
Well, maybe they should, goddammit!
No, they don't!
Chronicles is written, produced, and edited by Ryan Rodriguez. Executive producers are Tracy Rodriguez and Luis Rodriguez. Original music by Bildschirm. Please visit bildschirm.bandcamp.com for more information.